Revelation chapter 3, and we'll start in verse 7. Revelation chapter 3 and verse 7 says, "Unto the angel of the church in Philadelphia, write these things, saith he that is holy, he that is true, he that hath the key of David, he that openeth and no man shutteth, and shutteth and no man openeth. I know thy works. Behold, I have set before thee an open door, and no man can shut it, for thou hast a little strength, and hast kept my word, and hast not denied my name. Behold, I will make them of the synagogue of Satan, which say they are Jews and are not, but do lie. Behold, I will make them to come and worship before thy feet, and to know that I have loved thee. Because thou hast kept the word of my patience, I also will keep thee from the hour of temptation, which shall come upon all the world to try them that dwell upon the earth. Behold, I come quickly. Hold that fast which thou hast, that no man take thy crown. Him that overcometh will I make a pillar in the temple of my God, and he shall go no more out. And I will write upon him the name of my God, and the name of the city of my God, which is New Jerusalem, which cometh down out of heaven from my God, and I will write upon him my new name. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches." And we'll stop there. I was thinking about the scripture and just kind of going over the scripture, and one of the things that kept coming to me that I kept thinking about over and over again was the very first part of how he says that he has a door that no man can open. And I remember a message a long while ago that Joey Nelson had preached in revival, and he had preached one time about how when God shuts a door, that when he shuts that door, that no one can open that door. But if God opens up that door, no one can shut it. And I said, I thought about that just for a little bit, that how many times in our life we've all been there, it seems like it. We've waited for an answer. We wait for something to happen. We're waiting for the situation or the right time or whatever it might be in our life that we're waiting on. And it seems like that God just opens up a door and he makes a way. And you know, I remember a long time ago when I went to go to work at the vocational school, I remember we sat there and I was talking to the church, and I asked them, I said, I'm wanting to go look about doing this job, and I said, I want the church to pray about it. I want them to pray about this and really be sincere about God. And I remember that we sat and we brought to the altar and we all prayed about it, and then it seemed like after I went and God opened up the door. He opened up the door so wide that there was no way that no one could ever shut this opportunity. And as I began to look, and life, time went on, people got mad because I began to work for this place, because I was working on second shift. I was working in the evenings, and it seemed like some of them got mad at me. But I began to sit, and I began to thought. I thought to myself, I was like, well, you can't get mad at me for this. I said, because God is one that opened up this door and made this opportunity for me. And I said, and we all prayed about it. So if we all prayed about it, the only person you're going to get mad at it is not me, but it's going to be God. But I remember that how God opened up that door, and he made that door so wide that I went inside and I began to work. And you know, it wasn't much longer after that that when he opened up that door and made an opportunity that I could go and do this job, that the other job that I had, that I had had for so many years, began to close. It began to close. I remember that whenever I went and done that job, I was already working 40 to 50 hours a week for the other company that I was already working for. People began to look at me and say, well, you're crazy. Why are you wanting to work an extra 25 hours when you're already working 40 to 50 hours a week? And I looked at them. I told them, I said, you know, I feel like that's where I need to be. It's what I need to do. And I began to do this job and begin to work at it. And the next thing you know, the 40 and 50 hour week job that I had was gone. It was gone. It was done away with. And as it makes me think, it makes me go back to the scripture, what the scripture just said here, that God opens up a door. And when he opens up this door, no one can shut that door. When God opens it up, it's open. Whenever God shuts a door, no one else can open the door. I've said so many times, and we've had situations in our life, and you know, we all have situations we've been in. How many times have we all sat there and we begin to pray about something, and we begin to become getting. We say, okay, Lord, I'm going to throw this fleece out, and if this fleece is wet, and the ground around it is dry, then I believe this is what you want me to do. That, and God does that. We wake up, we check the fleece. The fleece is completely drenched in water. The ground's bone dry all the way around it. And we sit there and we say, okay, God, now, you know what? That was just a test. I was just trying to see if you were listening. And so then we go back the second time and say, okay, God, if this is what you want, then the fleece is going to be bone dry and the ground around is going to be wet. Well, sure enough, we wake up that next morning, we look at the ground. The ground looks like a pond. There's water all around everywhere. And we look at that fleece, and that fleece is absolutely bone dry. So then we begin to doubt. We begin to say, okay, is that what you really want me to do? Is that really what you want me to have in my life? Is it where you want me to be at? And we begin to doubt, even though we say, I said the thing Saturday night about how Cody went through and how he prayed about our fellowship service and who would preach the service and how he went the first time. He reached in and he pulled out Dave Lute's name. And he's like, well, Lord, it can't be him. He just preached our last one. And so he went in and he prayed about it again. He shook them all around. He took his hand and spun his hand around and he pulled out Dave out again. The how whenever sometimes it seemed like in our life that whenever God says, I opened up a door, or when God says, I shut the door, we want to act, we don't want to accept the answer that is laid in front of us. We don't want to accept what we have to do or what we need to do in life. And we need to understand that God is the one. As we read this morning in our lesson, the Bible said that Christ in Hebrews chapter 12 said he is the author and the finisher of our faith. As we said this morning, that if you can imagine, if you will, in heaven, that if you went into heaven, you went to the library, how that would be in that place, that you could look upon that shelf and there would be a book with your name on it. Because he was the author and finisher of your faith, that he wrote down your life. He wrote down everything. You know what? He knows every single thing you're going to do. And that's the thing about it. Whenever he died upon that cross, you were on his mind. Why? Because he knew every single thing you'd ever do in life. And most important thing of all, he knew that you need a Savior. He knew that none of us was perfect. No, not one. And not even the Son, but only the Father, which is in heaven, according to what Christ said. Only he is the perfect one this evening. So we know tonight that with everything that is done, everything that is said, that God is the ultimate. He is the one this evening that knows everything we're going through. And when God makes a way, it's up to us to follow his lead. It's up to us to understand that when the door is open, and it's something that we have prayed and we have prayed and we have prayed about, and that door is open, don't go back and second guess. Don't go. And I tell you, I can tell you another story. We went through, we wanted to buy a house. There's so many years we'd went through when we was young. And we was like, you know how I'd love to have a place of my own. I'd love to be able to, instead of renting a place, I'd love to have a house and call it mine. So we went through and we went with this realtor. And then this woman, she was a real nice woman. She was pregnant at the same time that Manny was pregnant with Allie. And she went to church, and she was a Christian, and she'd come over to the house, and we would talk about a scripture, and we'd talk about our families, and just everything seemed great. And we found this house, and we wanted this house so bad, and we sat and we thought to ourselves that, you know what, this is what we're going to do. We're going to put this in God's hands. And we said, God, if this is the place you want us to have, then make a way. But God, if this is not the place, then let your will be done. Well, when you went through and you signed a contract, you had to sign a contract, a 120-day contract, that in that 120 days that you would be able to seek financing, that you would be able to come up with the money. And if you couldn't come up with the money in that 120 days, then the contract was void and you was completely let out of it and everything would be fine. Nothing would ever be said. They wouldn't try to come at you with any money or you have to owe them anything or nothing. You used to walk away as if nothing ever happened. So we sat there at the house. We had about 10 days left, and our contract was about ready to be done. And that woman called, and she came over to the house, and she said, I know it's not going to be done in 120 days. She said, I know that you're not going to be able to get this house in 120 days, but, and see, that was the main thing, but if you sign this other paper that will extend it another 30 days, then I know I can get it done. You know, that ended up being the worst mistake of my life. God opened up the door,
Or I should say this, God shut the door. He made a way that I could get out of that mess and out of that contract to where I wouldn't have to worry about anything. My 10 more days was about ready to be ran to where I could just walk away scot-free and not have to do anything, not have to worry about anything, could stay exactly where I was at. But I listened to man. And I said, okay, we'd really like to have that place. I'll sign that paper. An additional 30 days, so within 150 days, we'll be able to get that place. Yeah, I'll do that, but see, that wasn't my original, that wasn't the original prayer that I prayed. My original prayer was putting it in God's hands. And here's what I begin to understand is this. If God made the heaven, the stars, and the moon, and the universe, and He made me, and He made you, and He made the trees, and the grass, and the rocks, and made all these things that we look at today, then what's 120 days to God? It's nothing. Do you think we have to set back, oh, wait a minute, God. You know what? I can see that you're tired. I can see that you're weary. And I'm going to give this. I'm going to give you 30 more days because I know that you don't have enough time for me. No, God don't work that way. See, last time I looked, God, Bible says that God is omnipresent. That means He is everywhere at all times. So we sit back and we think about, okay, then what's that mean? That means no matter where you go in this world, if every one of us walks out of this church and we walk a separate way and we go a different direction, God is with each and every one of us at the same time. Why? Because He is everywhere. He knows everything. There's nothing that seems that's hid from Him. There's nothing that seems that He don't know. There's nothing that He don't understand. He knows everything this evening. But see, God made a way for me to get out of that situation, and I didn't take it. So there's a lot of times in life that God can shut a door. And what we're trying to do is open up a side door to get what we want. I also remember the Bible says in John that who gave you desires of your heart and all you have to do is ask. But I also know that desires of our heart needs to be in God's will, that we need to understand that what we really need is not what we think that we need. Because you know what I realized in life? That how there's a lot of stuff that we sit back and we pray about and we're like, Lord, we need this or we need that. And you know what? A lot of times we don't really need this or don't need that. What we need is more sincerity toward God and to understand that God will give us what we need. In the hard times in life, that you know what, we may sit back, we may sit down at the table, we may not have a great big thick steak, we may not have ribs or whatever you may have, we may not have that. But I remember, like George and Carolyn said, they said one time, they said, yeah, I said, I remember a long time that almost every single day we had potato soup. And why did we have potato soup all the time? Why? Because they didn't have the money, they didn't have the funds. But God provided and God made a way to supply them with what they needed. It may not be exactly what we want in life, but the thing we have to understand is this, that what we really need is to be able to have just enough to sustain us, because this is not our life. This is not our home.